You know, so many Republicans came into this impeachment trial clearly with their minds made up. Did you go into this trial thinking that you'd be able to bring Senate 17 Republicans over to the view that Trump was guilty, or was this about the larger principle for Democrats?
I think all of the impeachment managers as a team made the decision that we were presenting this case to 100 senators, as well as to the American people. And we did that through the evidence. You know, we worked really hard, along with a tremendous team of professional staff, to present a case to the people of what happened on January 6th, and even leading up to January 6th. And I think that there's no question in anyone's mind that the President of the United States incited insurrectionists to not only storm the Capitol, but to try and stop our republic, the peaceful transfer of power. As you heard from Mitch McConnell's own speech, he said the House managers proved the facts. They proved the facts of the case. And he even pointed to the events leading up to that insurrection and the fact that we made that case. They have looked for an excuse as to why to not to hold the president accountable, and for that, they're going to have to answer.
Yeah, I mean, to that point, what went through your head when you heard McConnell essentially repeating your case to you after just having voted to acquit the former president, right? Donald Trump?
Just disappointment in an individual who did not have the courage to think that his country was more important than his party and his leadership. That was what I felt was great disappointment. As a parent and as an American, I think, however, that the thing that has given me hope is having seven Republican senators stand up for what's right, and knowing that the overwhelming majority of Americans believe in the events as we saw it and as we demonstrated by absolutely overwhelming evidence. All of those senators were witnesses to the crime themselves. And so I think that the evidence was there, and history will judge those who did not support the conviction harshly.
You said that you made your case on the evidence. You did not need witnesses. It would not have made a difference in bumping that number up higher than seven Republicans, which is completely understandable. As you said, even Mitch McConnell basically said that. However, there are some Democrats that I'm hearing from, you're probably as well, watching what happened and thinking that Senate Democrats, in their deal-making with Republicans, undercut you and other House managers by agreeing to go forward without witnesses.
I think that, you know, I'm not going to get in what the negotiations among Senate members are, but listen, we rested our case before the defense did. And we were pleased that we had overwhelming evidence that demonstrated the facts and that article of impeachment, that Donald Trump did what we say he did. It was then up to the defense to put forward a case. They did not, in my opinion. I think everyone was underwhelmed by what they said. They tried to come up with different theories that never addressed the issues at hand. And so on the night before today, last night, we found out that our colleague, Jamie Herrera Butler, did in fact issue a statement which additionally corroborated what we had already proven. We came in this morning, made a motion for a witness. That witness was her, as you saw, and we wanted that statement on the record. We got that, along with the Republican defense counsel, the counsel for the president, saying that he possibly wanted 100 witnesses. He didn't get that. And so I think what you saw after that was senators had made their minds, made their decisions, and those senators who voted against found an excuse not to do the right thing. And I know that people are disappointed, that Americans, listen, nobody wants to lose. I wanted to win this case along with all of the impeachment managers. I think you could see that in the amount of passion as well as meticulous work that we put into this case. And so finding a reason as to why these senators wouldn't do that just baffles most people's mind. And I think it's that they have not put their country above themselves or above their party.
We heard lead manager Jamie Raskin just a few moments ago say that he was the one who decided not to call Mike Pence and other potential witnesses. as a prosecutor and as someone who, as you've said, you were trying to build a record for history, never mind whether or not you had enough evidence, which you believe that you did, would you have liked to have heard from people like that for the record books, for the history books, regardless of whether it changed votes?
Let's remember that in the first impeachment trial, we were requesting a witness of Mr. McCann, right? That's still in litigation. That witness has still not come forward. And so are the American people going to wait for another year of us litigating to have the vice president come forward, who was not going to be a friendly witness? Kevin McCarthy was not going to be a friendly witness. They were going to drag this out in courts as long as possible. We believe that the evidence has shown what in fact happened in an overwhelming manner, and that history will judge it that way, as well as the American people saw what happened on January 6th. And, you know, the case was presented and the evidence was there. And whether those individuals came forward and spoke is never to be known. You know, one of the things as a prosecutor, you know, you don't of your own volition necessarily call a witness that you don't know what they're going to say. You don't know. I don't know what Mike Pence is going to say. He has, although he told the president he was not going to going to follow his last instruction to obstruct the constitutional powers duty that he had to certify the election, he went along with him for almost 4 years prior to that in all of the despicable things that this president did. So would he have told the truth? Who knows?
Yesterday afternoon, for those who have been watching these hearings, you took a moment to criticize the defense counsel's prevalent use of black women and people of color, talking about fighting in these video montages that they played. I want to play a little bit of that moment for our viewers.
I'll briefly say that defense counsels put a lot of videos out in their defense, playing clip after clip of black women talking about fighting for a cause or an issue or a policy. It was not lost on me, as so many of them were people of color and women and black women like myself, who are sick and tired of being sick and tired for our children, your children, our children. This summer, things happened that were violent, but there were also things that gave some of us black women great comfort. Seeing Amish people from Pennsylvania standing up with us, members of Congress fighting up with us. And so I thought we were past that. I think maybe we're not.
There's no question that what happened on January 6th has an undercurrent of white supremacy, anti-Semitism, and so much more. What message do you think this acquittal verdict sends to the white supremacists and domestic terrorists and to the people that they targeted, not just on January 6th, but in general?
Well, I think you've seen through the actions of some members of both the House and the Senate that they agree with some of those actions, some of them agreeing with it on January 6th and immediately thereafter, and some potentially by their vote. And I think that we need to be careful of what we have going on in this country, the kind of rhetoric as well as actions that have been condoned and fanned and flamed by the past president, Donald Trump. But I want everyone also to be aware that the majority of senators did not agree with that and voted against it. And the majority of members of the House in impeaching President Trump also agreed that that is not America. And so that as well should give us hope. There's a lot of work that we have to do. Listen, Abby, I believe that as a black woman, I had a responsibility to say something. If we're put in those places and put in those positions, that to whom much is given, much is required. And that was not an opportunity and not a place that I would not speak about what they were attempting to do in terms of dog whistles and gaslighting that was happening in those videos. And I think that we're going to continue to see people stand up, people like yourself, people like me, people like Dana Bash and others who believe in what's right and are going to call it when they see it.
You're also a prosecutor. and there's now the possibility that Trump could be charged criminally or civilly for some of the things that happened on January 6th. And before that, would you bring that case? Would you recommend that the Biden Department of Justice bring a criminal case against Trump now?
Well, I think that my job right now is to be a member of the House of Representatives. I'm not going to try and tell both the Justice Department, who will be run by amazing, fine people. I want to shout out my sister, Kristen Clark, who's heading up the Civil Rights Division coming up. And then to those individuals who are in the New York, the Attorney General, as well as in Fulton County. They're going to make decisions that are appropriate for their people, for the American people, and we'll wait and see.
Would you agree, though, that he is criminally liable at this point?
Listen, I think that the charges that we brought were, in fact, criminal. I think that we proved that he is, in fact, an inciter-in-chief. That is, in fact, criminal for an individual to raise themselves up to try and destroy this republic. He led an insurrection, albeit an attempted one that failed, but an insurrection against the republic. That is a high crime and a misdemeanor.
Before we let you go, we wanted to ask you to just reflect on what it's like to be a House manager in such a historic event like an impeachment in the trenches with your Democratic colleagues, many of whom, I should say, including yourself, are part of the younger generation of the Democratic caucus.
Oh, well, thank you for saying that I'm younger. I don't know if my children would agree with that. But what I will say is that, you know, no one could be finer than to have a lead manager like Jamin Raskin, who I also had the pleasure many, many years ago of being his student in law school as well. And so I think that there was a camaraderie, but also a teamwork, and knowing that we were there for a higher good to demonstrate that we will fight for this republic. Everyone just dug in. There was no great personalities. No one was better than the other. Everybody did the work, really trying to be very thoughtful, supportive, even critical of one another as we tried to prepare for this trial. Because who would have thought that a president of the United States would try and overthrow our government? And so we saw that as something that was profoundly important. And I think we and the tremendous, tremendous staff that was with us worked that way.